We've got Chumash on the Sardar. We've got Zacko. I'm gonna go with Zacko on the Darkseer. And lastly, we've got A on the Weaver. And this may be part of the reason why RMN is on the Dazzle. But for right now, RMN's hanging around this top lane. It may just try to be to counter out whatever Sentry Crystal Maiden may place to deal with Sandstorm, because in this lane, even though a lot of the times we see Sandstorm skip Sandstorm, it's now Crystal Maiden comes in, crush on it too, and he's taking quite a bit of damage, only has XR, he has a salve, nice body block coming out from Chubosh, but still Crystal Maiden's not doing very much damage. One more right click, going to get first blood. Misha with that little snowball being tossed out, going to get the kill and helping out ILTW this lane. Unfortunately, body blocks by Chubox are just too strong. And they're going to continue roaming, as now CM and Slaughter are moving up, but Radiant has a ward, so they know Dire's moving in here. Right now, RMN's still hanging around up here to shadow wave the one. I would ping that out to Chubosh. Nice! Oh my! Shadow wave! Yo! That Weaver was taken by surprise just as heavily as I was. Just a stray Pro Strike into... I think that was just one caustic finale explosion, but the shadow wave burst damage, even though Weaver had gone invis after the burst strike, shadow wave doesn't care and A goes down. Really nice play by RMN. I think it's a wise choice to keep this Dazzle up here, as Lone Druid does not need help against the Darkseer solo. He's not going to really be able to bully out the Darkseer, but still, Darkseer is not going to ever kill this Lone Druid. And we've got another rotation. They're not smoked up. And so... they weren't spotted by any wards, but... still hanging around here. And... oh, Dazzle spots them out now. RMN. They have the intel, but there's no easy way to make a turnaround, so right now they're just wasting Chubosh's time, kind of baiting as they go down into the river for a second, but Denby and Viver coordinated that, and they're still committing for this. Crystal Nova used, Chubosh looking for the crush, but doesn't find him. Meanwhile, Misha is taking quite a bit of damage from the Ignite, Tower Aggro is on the Troll, as is the Whirling Axe is on the Denby, but they're gonna get out, and Viver does not have the mana for another Ignite, as Misha takes down to the Orb of Venom, but is gonna survive with the Sunstrike, will get the kill. And they turn around that gank. Well played by RMN to kind of sit on that high ground and not really show that they know, but instead bait the gank attempt. And I'm really surprised that they went in so hard. Chubosh has an invisor. Meanwhile, General gets another kill on A in the top lane. Might get a kill on Misha as well. We've got a crush on Pikehead. He's going to Sash Ward off. His bear is going to die. But meanwhile, they finish off the kill on Crystal Maiden. General does not have Burrow Strike. He has a Mango if he needs it. But another kill onto the Sweeper. Now, Darkseer kind of getting low in his bot lane, but he's going to get up just fine. And Bear is actually on cooldown for 40 seconds. So Pikehead's actually kind of in a tough spot here. This Weaver is getting throttled by these Shadow Wave bombs.
What surge is this?
And I said that Dazzle was coming out with a Sentry Ward to counter out any Sandstorm, but really, it looks like RMN wanted to play aggressive from the beginning and use that Sentry Ward just so they could constantly have vision on the Weaver every time he goes into Shikuchi. Smoke is popped, and RMN walks face first into a Observer Ward, but he does not care whatsoever. 2 points in the Poison Touch. ILTW, though, has pretty high armor, 12 armor at this stage, so even 2 points in Poison Touch does not do very much. And Misha takes control of the mid lane while Troll Warlord decides to back off. Which is surprising, actually. Crystal Maiden is one of the few supports that can transition into the jungle and doesn't really need, like, to borrow a lane to gain EXP. That's okay, she's here. Whoever's running around. But again, Star Ward sees all the rotations. And Misha wants to go in experience range, but knows that with the slow 280 move speed, if she goes a little bit too far, my spell death is A, goes into Shikuchi in general, has 3 points in Burrow Strike, RMN. They're invading this area. And A is still hiding. He's going to take the Shikuchi damage. General is thinking about where to put the Burrow Strike. Still following each other around, now Slaughter is going to come in. General, gonna get crushed. Gonna get whacked, and this Island Chill doing a ton of damage. General uses the stick, but the Shikuchi damage wasn't used yet. And now, they get the kill. Shubush has a stun, he's going to use it. Gets a little bit of bonus damage because of the Storm minus armor. And the Sunstrike does not connect on the Shubush. So he gets out just fine. As well as planting, or as well as this fresh ward that Dazzle Place getting countered out. This will come in handy. A little bit aggressive. To get the last two. A little bit aggressive onto A. They invaded his jungle for quite a while, and General didn't really use Burrow Strike to get out. He had Burrow Strike the entire time, and as soon as he saw that TP, he probably should have gone for it, but probably did not expect the Ion Shell damage on top of Shufush. You know, just the Slaughter with Crush, that's not too big of a deal, but maxed out, well, at least now it's maxed out. Ion Shell is a substantial amount of hurt after you get stunned.
Dire's top tower is under attack!
Oh, Burrow Strike in onto the top lane. It's just one hero to get a Shadow Wave off of, though. As RMN's gonna pull creep aggro, and again, A, getting pretty harassed in this lane. I don't really know why Crystal Maiden is off doing other things. This is kind of a difficult game attempt. Frostbite is slow and all, and Pikehead does not have any mana to roar people off of his hero. To be able to roar people off. Oh, nice root! But another shell up, they want to go aggressive, gets a surge up onto Chubush, but the Savage Roar into the Bear to discourage that. Radiant has this board, so they know where Chubush is going to be, as Viver ready for a turnaround if they need to. Chubush going in, gets ignited, Crush only gets on the Bear, Fire Blast as well, Misha getting blocked out by these creeps, and just immediately going to evacuate, which is probably the smartest decision to make. Meanwhile, top lane, they're going in, and Crystal Maiden TP to the top lane? What? Well, I mean, that was giving her a hard time for not supporting A, but I don't really think she should have TP'd to the top lane after she loses nearly all of her HP in that bot lane gank. And yet again, RMN participating in another assist. Troll actually getting super low in the jungle. But there's no way that Ned deals vision for a Sunstrike. Shedendi has actually completed his Hand of Midas. Making progress on the Agony Scepter. His tower is getting kind of low. A really wants to go for this deny, but this is a kind of a tricky deny. Actually gonna go aggressive now. General this time uses the Burrow Strike to get out. There's still swarm damage, and A has the Shikuchi, but he's not gonna use it. He's just gonna go for the deny. Meanwhile, mid lane, they're going in on ILTW now. A gets the deny on the top lane, but this off lane did work. Between Dazzle and Sand King, able to really shut down this Weaver, who's, well, was 5th lowest net worth and now 4th lowest net worth. I don't know why Troll has decided to be, like, a jungle hero now. LTW is so far behind the mid lane, while Dandy on this Invoker has been more so than Freeform, because he's been able to go into the jungle and not lose very much experience, and now he's back up. He's gonna get the Burrow Strike? No, there's not enough mana, but he has a wand, he has a mango if he needs it. But with only Biver to follow up. Is this a Helm of the Dominator? Oh, interesting. I didn't know Dominator Darkseer is a thing. But Zacko goes for the Dominator. That's an interesting build. And the Purge Creep is always useful, and he can actually put the Surge on the Purge Creep, which 425 move speed with that boosted Helm of the Dominator is nice, but why not make it 550 with the Surge? Is that the new search move speed? I'm pretty sure it is.
Empire's middle tower is under attack.
Dazzle, TPing out of the top lane.
Dire's middle tower.
And now they lose their mid tower with no defense whatsoever. I don't know what Comanche is doing. I don't know what Troll specifically is doing. Like, he's jungling, and he didn't even go for an Iron Talon. He has a Korgan's shield and a Crawling Blade. Like, I know Troll isn't the best mid laner, but Invoker isn't going to get a kill on a ranged form Troll, in my opinion. I don't know why LTW is playing like this anymore. Like, I'm good for going in on Zacko, because the fire blood is on strength going in. No root, unfortunately. That entire kill attempt hinged on Pycat getting a root. The Sunstrike still connects, though, and he's going to use his shrine. Zacko gets 7. And he's currently 1-1 on this Dark Seer.
Selfish.
I'm still really curious about this Helm build. I don't know what Comanche is up to right now. Like, what's their plan? They've given up two fairly important towers in the first 10 minutes, and they haven't really gotten much in return. They haven't gotten anything at all. Their Darkseer is the highest farming hero. The offlane is the highest farming hero for Comanche right now, because Weaver, as we all know, got just bodied in his lane, and Troll Warlord is a jungle warlord. See what Comanche can do to recover from this, but normally I would say, okay, your Darkseer is the most farmed hero. Get something like a Blink Dagger and start turning aggressive, but a Helm of the Dominator, it's like a pushing item almost. And, you know, Comanche has a okay pushing comp. I say that just because of the Troll Lord, but the Troll, it's not really that heavy push, but Zacko going in vacuum only on the Dazzle with the True Flash Blink Dagger. Actually, Slaughter has a Blink Dagger extremely early on. They're chasing down Arm, and he has Grave. He might TP out, but he has 8 launch charges if he wants to. Instead, he's just gonna draw aggro from the rest of Comanche, sacrifice himself as he did put Weave on Comanche, so this push might be a bit difficult. Pycat backs out with Viver. They might just go back in. Because Na'Vi is much stronger than Comanche right now. A does not have very much. There's the epicenter coming in from General. He has his Blink Dagger. He's going to go in onto the Darkseer. Sunstrike connects and the Fire Blast to finish it off. Both these heroes. I'm so surprised that Slaughter got his Blink Dagger so early, but the more important Blink Dagger in that fight was General's Blink Dagger follow up with the epicenter. And now might go in on Viver. They have a vision of him with this ward. They're gonna pop this rain drop with the Shikuchi. Corrosive Haze. Chubush is not opting to go in, but they're gonna get the kill with that Corrosive Haze and the reckless damage of the double damaged Weaver. As they blink in aggressively, but no TPs to be found. And Chubush comes up empty. So they're playing aggressive now. It just wasn't with the hero that I was expecting. Slaughter quietly moving up the ranks in terms of farm. And a lucky double damage rune as well on Weaver. Now this push is much easier. Battle Strength's used, Glyph is down. The rest of Na'Vi are instead going for Roche, but this is kind of a slow Roche. There's no minus armor on anyone. These Quarter Spirits don't drop Roche's armor. There's no Blightstone, there's no like Wave of Terror, but they're still doing a pretty good job on this. Between Alacrity and just having a bear, Battlecry wasn't actually even used. Pycat has not leveled True Form, despite being level 12, finds having points to Savage Armor much more important, so they didn't even use Battlecry. And Na'Vi, they take a Roche, lose a Tier 1 bot, and lose about half of a Tier 2. Another might go in general, gonna get Blink Dagger cancelled, but instead, Ake is gonna go aggressive, Throw Strike is used, and as well as the Frostbite immediately popping Aegis on Pycat, who still does not have any points in True Form. Savage Roar is used to get Chubash off, but it actually is not timed properly, as meanwhile Ake gets a kill onto Viver, Grave is used onto Pycat, he's taking a lot of damage, Comanche going in, and they're gonna get a kill onto Dazzle, and they're gonna get the kill onto the Lone Druid. Blink in, not gonna find anything as General blinks further, but he gets detected by the Whirling Axes. ILTW is following him around. General tried to blink to the burst to the high ground, but that doesn't really work, as the vacuum is gonna break the trees. They're gonna find General. Misha does not have any mana for Frostbite. General's still on the run, now has a Corrosive Haze, so no more juking is going to be available. They're thinking, they're waiting to go. Chibush is waiting for his Blink Dagger, I guess. They're canceling the Blink Dagger of General. He throws strikes, gets the crush, and they're gonna finish off General. That was a terrible position to challenge a tier 2 defense as Navi. Pycat lost both of his lives coming in this way, which they couldn't have known that Dire has a ward here. But it's a pretty, like, when they're pushing tier 2 this aggressively, chances are there's either a ward somewhere here by Dire, there's a ward somewhere here by Dire. This is probably the least likely ward, but since tier 1 Radiant is still up, it's a pretty typical ward to have. Armin gets spotted by A, has Grave TP, and he's just gonna go for it. Pycat did not have his Barret's came up either. It's really ballsy to not go for true form this late into the game, in my opinion. Especially now that Stargard has his Blink Dagger. The bonus armor that Battlecry provides you is very important. And obviously just having more HP in case you need it, whenever you think you're about to die, like how Pycat died in that bot lane. Dende completes his Zags. Working on BOTs next. Puts out a meteor, push out the lane. Is Slaughter in the vicinity? He's probably gonna go for a Blink Star Crush, but not anyone. Worth the shot. They don't have scan up. Let's take a look at the net worth. It is. Navi had a little spike after they took Roche and then promptly shot downwards when they went for that tier 2 defense. Which meanwhile I didn't notice, but the tier 2 top Comanche went down at some point. Which is actually pretty important. There's a smoke up by ILTW and the rest of Comanche. There's also a smoke up by General and Avi's gang, and Dendi unfortunately caught first before Comanche gets caught by the... Oh, the Blink Crush? No, Blink Dagger's on cooldown by Chibush. So close. A was about to pop the smoke of Navi, and with General initiating, and Dendi was about to pop the smoke of Comanche with Slaughter initiating, and unfortunately, Dendi was in the wrong place at the wrong time.
Radiant's middle tower ain't radiating no more, I'll vouch for that, you know what I mean? Radiant's middle tower is under attack!
Yeah, so that net worth is only slightly in favor of Comanche, but you have to keep in mind that there are three heroes that follow Dendi's net worth. Dendi's the highest net worth, which is to be expected with an Aghanim's and, I mean, with a Midas and the fact that he's been basically farming uninhibited for the most part. They're BOTing on the bear. He wants to go for play onto ILTW, who does not have anything like a BKB. So he doesn't see anything yet, but ILTW wisely backs off after taking that wave, and Pycat and Dendi not gonna find anything. And Radiant has this ward, so they saw that Troll has basically given up and he's not moving into the jungle either. Yeah, so the top net worth is owned by Dendi, but then it's followed by three Dire heroes, and the Lone Druid is about 1.5k net worth behind the Troll Warlord. And this Troll Warlord was not off to a good start. This Weaver was not off to a good start. They managed to recover fairly well. Actually finally seeing the Sage and Yasha for once. An item that has fallen out of favor substantially, but I think Troll Warlord is one of the best heroes to take advantage of it. Yesterday when we saw a Troll, he went just for the Yasha. But that Troll also lost, since they're smoking up, they're going in on General, they need to get this Blink off properly. And they do it. Immediate follow-up Blink by ILTW as well, and that Viper on the run, going to get far less on the Stargard, but that's just stalling the inevitable as Corrosive Haze. They get a ton of damage, and they still are chasing, they want Armin. The Centaur Conqueror walking in and has a stun if he needs it, so Armin goes for the grave, but that's just stalling. Oh my god, there's... He puts up this tree, this is the... I've seen RMN do this before, and it worked. Oh, smart usage of Swarm. Now he's gonna go look around, but the Swarm bug dies! And A still can't get in, even though he has Crimson Haze, the range, because A does not have a Dragon Lance on this Weaver. RMN, what a player! I can't believe he planted that tree to block it out. He's done that multiple times. That was so sick. RMN immediately redeemed himself for all this questionable Tusk plays. Cold Snap onto Chewbush. But it's actually Invoker that's going to die. It's the Sand King that's going to die as well.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
I'm still super psyched about that tree play. And I'm not just building it up more because I want to redemption for RMN. But the fact that he has that presence of mind to do that in such a high-pressure situation, it's like, I know the one unit that will block. It's just one unit wide, and the tree's just right in the right place. A went for a Lincoln Sewer for his item. Which is why he's gonna die. He completes the Dragonlance. Yeah, see, that was why I was surprised. Because typically Weavers do go for the Dragonlance pretty early on, and I don't really know why A felt the desire to go for a Lincoln's this early on. I imagine it's because Sand King got super early Blink Dagger, and so the possibility to cancel out the Burrow Strike initiation is what A is most concerned about. So I can understand it, especially given the fact that he has such a bad start. Now, Pycat does have True Form, and he does have Battle Cry. But A already with the defense. Now, if he's still in the mood to speak, they've actually smoked up now. They're faking. Comanche didn't know that something's up. You don't bring that many heroes to a tier 1 push and then just leave. Unless you've got something up your sleeve. Nice sentry. They're gonna spot out where A is. And they know where the rest of Comanche is. His general gets a burrow strike onto Chewbush. Sunstrike going to get the kill. Blink in by the Troll Warlord as well as the Battlecry. Gonna get tornadoed up. And the Ice Wall is gonna continue kiting him as RMN is going to die without being able to use Chalice Grave. The general comes in with a burrow strike, gets a kill onto the Troll Warlord. There is a freezing field used briefly, but the Crystal Maiden is cancelled. As now Misha going to go down. Frostbite is used off general, so they're gonna get the kill at least on the Sand King. But the root onto the Weaver, and Time Lapse is already used, so down goes the carry on Comanche, and four heroes go down. This is one of the high grounds that you need to be concerned about whenever you're sieging as Dire. It's not often that you see fights break out here, and it's not often that Dire won't have a ward somewhere here or here if they go for that. They have a ward here, but I think that was placed after the fight. Yeah, that was placed either mid-fight or... It was placed mid-fight. I'm Misha, I'm imagining. They took away the ability to see who planted a ward, or like, who owns the ward. That used to be useful. Yeah, Zacko has gone for a very defensive build. This Helm of the Dominator helps out with the aura, the HP regen. So how much HP regen is this Darkseer providing for his team when he's standing around him? So the pipe provides 4 aura regen, the helm provides 8 aura regen. So him just standing around gives his team 12 HP per second. Like Sardar sitting around it. Zacko's just kind of sitting back. I want to see the number change. But whatever, just take my word for it. Sunstrike gonna come in. It's not going to detect how much HP Roach is at. And they're gonna get that pretty much uncontested. Okay, now I can see it. So, Troll was at like 1 point something? 2.4? Damn it! Zacko, stand next to him! What's Misha at? Well, of course, Misha does high because Tranquil Boots. Whatever. Yeah, okay, so the Centaur has 17 HP to regen per second. Oh, wait, Mechanism War also. Holy crap! Didn't even add that. So yeah, 17 HP regen per second. What a build by Zacko. I'm sorry I spent so much time on that. I just was really... I've never seen this build before this early in the game. I've seen the pipe mech, obviously, but I haven't seen the Helm of the Dominator on top of that. Is it going to smoke up now? Were they spotted? Oh yes, they were absolutely spotted by Radiant. But Na'Vi doesn't feel confident enough to challenge the smoke, they're just gonna run from it. Still smoked up here. Biver spots out A, and they're gonna get the vision onto Biver as they're trying to get that ward, but instead Troll Roller plays it and gets a 3x multicast, and then probably Savage Ward has to run away. Radiant Sword is about to die. They're gonna kill it anyway and get that 100 gold. Meanwhile, there's the Bro Strike on this aggressively blinking Chuvash. They're gonna put the Blinking Spear on the Stargar. Get out. Stargar's still taking quite a bit of damage. Meanwhile, Dendi was pushing out a top tier 3. And he did a lot of damage to this top tier 3. This Force Spirit is about to kill this. And Zacko's gonna defend it. Wow, that did so much damage. Didn't he go for dual Force Spirits? No, he actually went for XP again. Still though, that's so much tier 3 damage. Uncontested. We're still slightly in favor of Comanche at this point, but nothing too substantial at 26 minutes in. ILTW still has not gotten very much done with this Aegis. Still has it for like 2.5 more minutes. Comanche keeps running away from their pushes for some reason. Like, it made sense for Zacko to go back and defend tier 3s, but if it was just the Darkseer, and the rest of Comanche should have been able to push this tier 2, which is almost dead now, but instead they give up on it and start moving up to the top lane. And meanwhile, bot lane's getting pushed in by Pycat. Chuvash is here. Slimmer keeps himself ghost in onto the Lone Druid. Pycat's pretty safe, gets force staffed back by somebody, but blink in by ILTW, does not activate his BKB yet. Oh my gosh, that one right click on the courier almost kills it. And once again, Armin sacrifices himself for the greater good, but Chuvash wants more, puts the Crows of Haste onto Dendi, and Zacko finishes off the Dazzle. Chuvash has a Blink Dagger in 5 seconds, but the Blink Dagger on Troll rolls up, no bashes though, gets a maim on the Biver, so he's pretty slow now. Chuvash's Blink Dagger is up, they're gonna get the crush, they're gonna get the kill onto Biver Ogre Magi, but only the two supports of Na'Vi go down. ILTW still has about a minute and a half left on this Aegis. Wait, a minute and a half. A does not have a Desolator completed, he's actually going to be going for a Maelstrom? Okay. I thought that Desolator may be a bit more important, but is it going to be able to push fast enough with just Battle Trance? Ice Ball is going to be put up. FTW could blink over it if he wants to, but instead they're just going to leave. Both of these teams are just terrified of teamfights. No one wants to engage in the teamfight. Comanche, despite having an Aegis and a fresh 10-second BKB on Troll, just does not want to fight. And probably not until Weaver completes something more. I mean, he has his Maelstrom completed now, but I feel like A is pretty strong right now. The top two networks will... used to be the top two networks, but they're still owned pretty... Oh, okay, it was Podcast owned Force Stuff, aka Hurricane Clark. Thank God I'm out of that bot situation. Looks like Na'Vi might want to smoke up. Aegis is down now for Troll, and they know that timing, so now is the good time to go in. A goes in and doesn't even bother getting the Lincoln Spear popped. He didn't know where General was, since so just immediately time-lapsed after seeing the Ogre. Oh, blink out by Chuvash. Biver uses the dust. It does catch Chuvash, but... very slow-paced game. There's not really much more to say besides that. It hasn't been like a full 5-on-5 team fight. Ever? I don't think there's been a full 5-on-5 team fight at all. I mean, anytime all 10 heroes are in the same spot, one team is usually running away from the other team. I got working on a Scotty. Okay, spot out Misha, who will be dead for certainly. ILTW actually wants to go in on this. They're gonna blink right Chubash onto Pycat. ILTW didn't actually go in on it, but nice vacuum, and they're going to get the kill, and Dendi's BOTs gets cancelled as they were going onto the bear. So they can continue and almost spot out Biver, but ATP's back to base. Again, no 5-on-5 teamfights. I'm pretty sure that Invoker wanted to make it a 5v5, but BOT got cancelled, and so not gonna happen. Is Dendi working on a Sheepish guard, actually? As of pretty soon, probably in about another minute and a half. This tier 2 finally got gonna get finished off by LTW. Meanwhile, Dendi might finally get finished off this tier 1. And now another tier 2 getting pushed out, but Comanche are gonna back off. As meanwhile, Blink and Chubash spots out this Dazzle, and this of course he gets bashed. Fireman trying to pick up the last hit before he dies, but instead gives ILTW the kill. And he was probably going for the denial, but I strongly doubt that he was going to pull that off.
A soldier's fortune.
Two important items are just now completed. Blink Dagger on Zacko. This guy has so much. He went for the 14 health regen talent. He has 43.3 HP regen per second, and that's without any Guardian Greaves aura. That's hilarious. His Darkseer, I don't know why his Darkseer doesn't want to fight. He's so geared up towards fighting, and yet he just never wants to touch an enemy hero or get touched by an enemy hero. Part of me almost wonders if, like, Blademail Darkseer is a viable follow-up as they spot out Pycat. I don't know if they know that they're taking Island Shell damage, but I don't know why Chubash goes in on Biver as opposed to the Lone Druid. But Pycat gets out. And now they're going in, BKB activated, they spot out Dendi, and with this crystallis damage on the door, Troll Warlord, he immediately goes down. There is buyback available if they want to use it, and that was ILTW's first BKB usage, despite completing it a very long time ago. A has a double damage rune, or for a little bit longer, but he's too concerned about getting rude, so they're going to back off. And they actually forced out the buyback as they're continuing to push up the top. Dendi, Blink, Tornado. Chubash gets all of his mana burned off, but Greaves gives him back a little bit. As Misha's on this low ground, let's be a little bit careful. General's pushing up the bot line meanwhile. And of course, they're not gonna fight it. I mean, it makes sense for our ILTW not to fight it, because his BKB was down. And you forced out the buyback of the Invoker. Sunstrike gonna come in. Zacko's gonna pick up the cheese. Dude, I'm tall. I still think Blademail Darkseer could be pretty hilarious if you go all of this regen. I bet he wishes there was like a double soul ring that you could sacrifice even more HP for mana. Because really, he only has one mana item, aside from the Guardian Greaves, it's just the Soul Ring. And the Guardian Greaves, oh, spots out general, but yeah. Weaver. Going to be, what is he going for? Mjolnir. Oh man, that's what it is. You give him Mjolnir and you put it on the Darkseer, and then he just sits on the high ground. Brilliant. Pycat almost has his Scotty completed. Yeah. I mean, the teams have been smoking quite a bit as well, and still, like, no real 5-on-5 teamfights. A lot of Radiant Vision right now. There's this ward. There's this ward. There's Dazzle. And they were actually kind of onto him, but smoke's not gonna pop. Misha walking on the border to see if the smoke pops, but it's not. So they're gonna continue pushing. And again, all outer towers are taken by Comanche. A troll completes a Bloodthorn, which is another very valuable item because Dendi is still working on this Shiva's Guard. He has the money for it, but I mean, after buying back, he knows that he doesn't really need a save for buyback. It's not going to be back for another 4 minutes. What is this? That's the Dire Courier. Yeah, I guess he just can't get a secret shot, which is going to suck because it would be really nice. Wow, that was such a quick... Like, why would you bother time-lapsing up? I mean, Shikushing up? Maybe Comanche just wanted to scout out to see if Na'Vi were in their base or not? Because... they didn't see anything, but he just like immediately goes up, time lapses out, and that's not gonna happen for another 20 seconds. Wow, DW stays in the range, one does quite a bit of damage, too much, gets the crush onto the Ogre Magi, but he's taking quite a bit of damage. It's rooted himself, the Ogre's gonna go down first, the Startup is going to follow up immediately after Shalabit very early on to Invoker. It's ILTW going to give up his Aegis. Doesn't have his BKB on the second life. Tornado timed properly. ILTW going to get out at the cost of a bunch of mana, but he still gets out. Nice defense by Na'Vi. But meanwhile, I think Weaver was pushing out this mid lane, and so that explains why they were able to take that fight. Weaver wasn't contributing, so A took an objective, and as a result, Comanche's going to get two objectives. Both shrines go down, and 300 more gold into the pockets of everyone on Comanche. Killed this bear. Yeah. Oh, come on. That's the... come on, A. The Storm Bug is still canceling it out, but Troll did not want to go for the blank to finish off the bear. Come on, kill it. Aww. You gotta watch out for that roar. You're a Weaver. It's not too difficult to dodge. As a result, Icat successfully completes his Scotty because the bear was buying the last ultimate orb. He's at level 20, so he has that respawn time talent now. I'm gonna be so hyped when the first team fight happens. They're gonna be like spells being used by all the heroes, and it's gonna be great. I mean, the top lane defense was somewhat of a team fight, but A evaded the whole thing. General was gonna TP out meanwhile on the top lane. Chuvash might need to be careful, but he blinks out. No, this Weaver's an illusion, but nice tornado read on a Chuvash. He's tornadoed up for quite a while. She was following up Dendi in with this super fast ghost bug move speed. Stays just out of range of the crush. Chuvash is really getting lucky with these solar crest procs, but he's gonna go down eventually. Had a shadow blade, but got rooted by the bear, so it wouldn't have mattered. And is there any detection? Tykat doesn't really have anything. Poker doesn't really have anything. Still haven't followed up on that tier 3 damage that Dendi did earlier. I'm surprised that Dendi just hasn't BOT'd up to the top lane and just, like, tried to backdoor it with him and a Forge Spirit and Alacrity. because if you can get Trinexus, that would be pretty nice, because Roche has gone the way of Comanche for the second and third. The first Roche went to Radiant, but we all remember how that defense went as they went up here and then promptly gave up the Aegis. So being able to regain Roche control would be important for Na'Vi, because I imagine most of the reason why they're playing passive is because Comanche just constantly has the Aegises and cheeses. It was a line drawn by the Weaver. This, like this. I don't know what that meant. Troll working on a butterfly. But he still has room to grow. Still, Moonshard is amazing on Trolls, so I imagine that will probably be his next item after completing the Butterfly. He may go for an MKB, but looks like Pikeff's already beating him to the punch, and he's going to probably finish this MKB before Troll finishes his Butterfly. I don't know what Na'Vi are looking for. I'm going to go for a smoke. Oh, okay. I think they're pinging out the top tower, so they might actually just go for that back door. Wisely, Zacko blinks out. They spot out the centaur. Bivor's gonna be the initiator. And a long-range Agon Scepter Burrow Strike onto Zacko. Nice! Nice vacuum. 5 hero vacuum, but unfortunately did not go for the wall. And now A wants to fight, but it's too little too late. Animal on animal violence. The 5 hero smoke, and it's a pretty high net worth enemy. Darksteer going down, but with the Darksteer not having buyback, which they don't know for sure, but still, like, yeah, I don't know why not they wouldn't go for a push now. This tower is so low. Troll Warlord needs to just right click it like 2 times. And it's not like there's like an RP or a Ravage or some other devastating teamfight ultimate that could catch out all 5 of Na'Vi. Especially if the Darksteer is dead. Like, theoretically, it could be vacuum, but Darksteer is dead. I don't know why. Oh. If you watch underneath the Shadow Blade, there's no detection. Bivor now finds an Observer Ward. It's stunned out by Juvash. It's a bash. And that's the dead Ogre Magi. And Juvash doesn't jump, so he's gonna take away that freshly planted ward as well. And back to doing nothing. Roche is up now. I don't know if either team knows. Chubosh is gonna find out. He finds out. He's gonna start doing it. Na'Vi have no vision of this whatsoever. Now this ward is gonna spot Misha walking towards it. And now the tornado comes in. Gonna tornado him up, but A is attacking so fast with this Mjolnir and the girls with A's. Fourth Roche going to Comanche. The cheese ever used by Weaver? He only has one cheese now. Oh, other cheeses? No, I guess he must have used the cheese at some point. ...43 minutes. 38 kills. Not necessarily a low kill number, but still, like, I don't know, this game has felt so patient. Both teams. And patience is a virtue, but there's the line. I think both teams have crossed that line. A doing the same thing as last time, split pushing mid while the rest of his team split pushes another lane. No, they're gonna join up. Bot lane getting pushed by Chuvash and Zacko. As Na'Vi are leaving. General TP is down. I guess TP, Bivor has a TP, but that means that this tower is not bloodlusted right now. I don't know why Navi is leaving. Danny gets a tornado because the EMP going to be a little bit too early. No, perfectly timed it. It immediately activates BKB. It's a little bit more damage. He does not want to get rooted here. He needs to be very careful. He has such slow moves because he has no boots, which is the thing that Weavers do, by the way, in case you've been wondering. General's still pushing out his top lane. He has his TP up now, but mid lane. I can push him by RTW. He's probably going to activate BKB as soon as he hits the ground, or he's going to wait for Aegis Blade. McDavid's used Blink and Mike Chew Rush General immediately follows it up. ILTW's taking a ton of damage, but he probably just wants to get rid of his Aegis life. Now probably gonna come up and activate BKB. Unless he's gonna get Savage Roar, no, he's just gonna blink out and activate BKB. Come on! Just fight each other! Chew Rush gets tornadoed, crossbite onto the Sand King, and actually Slurk is pushed up with the Deafening Blast, so he's gonna get down. Misha takes a fair amount of damage from that Sunstrike and is ultimately gonna go down. I can't believe that Sardar surfs up to the cliff and gets out of that situation. I just don't understand. It's an important game, I know. This is KIEV Major Qualifier. There's a chance to fight at a Valve Major, but, like, come on. I haven't seen Darksteer, like, do anything aggressive with this Blink Dagger yet. I haven't seen, like, any Blink Vacuums to low ground, I haven't seen any Blink Vacuum initiations, and Navi's been positioning themselves fairly well. After they took down Troll with that Aegis, they didn't all, like, clump around and be like, oh, okay, we're gonna kill him whenever he comes out of his Aegis again. Now, they were all pretty far apart from each other, but you don't need to get a 5-man Vacuum every time. If you kill the Invoker, then immediately the fight becomes very easy for Comanche, because this Lone Druid, he's pretty big, but I think that Comanche are able to kill him. This MKB pickup is really important for Pyget, though. There was the Solar Crest on Chewbacca, there's the Blind from, well, oh snap, they catch up! ILTW, still hasn't activated his BKB yet, holding on to it, that may be his life if he still continues. Now he still hasn't activated it, now he activates it, but he's on the run, he's gonna take a lot of Sunstrike damage if he actually runs south. He doesn't have any weight either. I don't know why he ran south. But he does. And he dies. Okay. Now, at least force out a buyback. Dendi only needs to right-click this tower, like, once, and he goes down. The Comanche are not in a position to defend this at all. Zacko is off in the mid lane. A is down here in the bot lane. He doesn't have a TP! Oh god! A doesn't have a TP. It's getting sent in on the courier, but Force Spirit? Oh my gosh, the Force Spirit almost kills it. But no, of course they don't. Of course they don't push it. Then the BOT is at the bot lane instead. And the Troll is not going to have to even think about buying back. Fortune. Chewbush underneath the Shadow Blade. General has a gem. They're gonna try to go in on Dendi, but it doesn't work. And General pops Link into A. The bed throw strike. A takes a bit of damage from the Lone Druid, but they're gonna kill off that Stormbug. Now Chewbush in a lot of trouble, and he's gonna probably give up a gem. And give Pycat an unstoppable streak. They don't care about the gem. Instead, they want to get kills. Look to Armin to get the gem. There's a tornado, and it comes out, but it does not connect on anything other than energy creeps. Did anyone pick up the gem? Are you kidding me right now? Doesn't Dazzle have? Okay, whatever. Now they want to push. When there's a gem on the deck that they could be picking up, they're like, no, there's no time. We have to push. There's no time to put something in your backpack. This bear had a double damage run earlier. I started doing a little bit of damage, but this bear is very, very slow. What, the Demon Edge Bear? I think that's actually pretty... Wait, but he's not... Never mind. I don't understand Demon Edge Bear. Dendi takes down the top tower. What a play! Dendi, breaking the backdoor protection by pushing this bot lane, kills the top tower with a Forge Spirit. Biggest play of the game. by far. Actually, wait, no, that Arm and Iron Branch play is still the biggest play. And yet, despite all these big plays, Comanche still has a 10k lead. They used to have a 20k lead, but then they gave up, like, 6 kills back-to-back-to-back. LTW is working on a satanic? What is he gonna draw for that? It's the same Yasha. So what's up with this demon edge bear? I don't get it. Yes, it's the health of bear. Oh, no, they don't need to put it back on himself. Oh, I think I know what it was. I think Pycat... Actually, no, I don't know what it was. I think Pycat used the bear to go to the secret shop to pick up the demon edge, and then he just never put it on a zero. They pop the Lingans successfully on the Weaver. They're gonna burst right in it, but A has enough time to time up. Finally, a blink in into a three-man wall. Down goes Pycat to ILTW, and now ILTW is continuing to push. A has his BKB, and so he's gonna go in on Dendi, who has Corrosive Haze. They're gonna get the kill. Who doesn't look at kills? As now Bitter is going to go down, and Comanche finally take a team fight. And guess what? They win it because they've been 10k net worth ahead. They're gonna get the buyback out on the Invoker. Okay, for some reason, Troll Warlord felt like BOTing down to, I don't know why, this push. Backdoor protection is up right now. But this is Battle Trance, they go through a nice lift activation though. Oh, so that's why he was BOTing, I guess. But still, they do so much damage. And no one is up except for Dendi. Yes, thank you. Push into backdoor protection, I don't care. Except you need the Weaver and the Troll to do this. Alright, whatever. They take a melee Rex. Tornado on 2. She doesn't need it. Sunstrike. Fifth Roche going. Well, the fourth Roche to Comanche. Fifth Roche overall. There have been a lot of early Roche respawns. There would be 5 Roches at this point. Who has cheese? Stargar has cheese. Moving in towards its bot lane. Okay, there is no backdoor protection. No strike. Oh man, it's a lot of damage coming in on A, but his time lapse is now a 4-man! Or 4-hero! Immediately vacuum wall, yeah. They're going to fight. Down goes Armin. He gets fighting off against A. Down goes the Sand King. Back by the Tornado onto Weaver, but he still has this. And he has this level 5 Jakuchi down as well. He is single-handedly zoning out Nafi as the rest of Comanche are taking objectives. Uses his Aegis Life. This Ice Wall is making it difficult for Comanche to help him, but guess who does not care about an Ice Wall? This little bug. ILTW. No, ILTW is the right idea. Stop that A. Go help him take this top tier 3. The center comes in and does not really do very much because Pipe is there and down goes. Whoa! Actually, Troll died to Pycat. And now Burrow Strike in on to Misha. He surged up so he's gonna get out of that ice wall. And A actually finally does go to the top and takes out top tier 3. But I don't know why he just wasn't helping Troll take that in the first place. Instead of going to take this range tracks. Like, who cares about a range tracks 54 minutes into the game? Na'Vi are on the cusp of being mega'd. Pycat had to buy back. But he's pretty much 6 play. He must have gotten some very lucky crits to get that kill on Troll. Oh man, and a Blade Mail actually picked up by Troll. very wise choice.
A soldier's fortune.
Hope Shubash doesn't do anything dumb. One of these heroes have a vision. It'd be cool. Give the cheese to yourself. I don't know. I mean, like the, whose buybacks are down right now? Lone Druid and Invoker's buybacks are both down. And Sand Kings. Three Na'vi heroes don't have buyback right now. They want to smoke. But if there was ever a time to go for Megas, it's when half of the enemy team does not have their buybacks. Because what more items could you possibly be waiting for? ILTW doesn't even have anything queued up. He's already eaten the Moon Shard. He's basically 6 on. He's sold Insane Jinyasha. I'm gonna go for a smoke, but it's so far back. Like, by the time they get over to Na'vi's part of the map, they're not gonna have very much time left on this smoke. I don't know why they smoked so far, they should have smoked around here. There's no way Na'vi has wards right now. But they're marching down, half of the smoke duration is used. This tornado cooldown on top by Invoker, along with the Octarine Core, makes it very difficult to push them. There's a little bit of time left on the smoke, but they're gonna go in back over protection. There's no glyph available for another 20 seconds. They're gonna take that melee Rex. Burst Strike in onto Zacko, who's not near his team. Blink Mill is activated by Pycat, and he hurts himself so much. Has to activate a Shrine. Meanwhile, ILTW is on the run. Gets a fair amount of damage. And now Burst Strike onto the Stardar. He's on the run. He has his BKB if he needs to activate it. General. Alright, well. They take a melee Rax, and now there's just one Rax left, one ranged Rax left. And still, three Na'vi heroes do not have buyback right now.
This'll come in handy.
BKB was used by Troll, BKB was used by A, BKB was not used by Chubosh. And now Misha has the cheese. Oh wait, there's one more BKB, I didn't even realize Darkseer has his BKB. He didn't even realize he has his BKB, he's only used it once. I've never seen a Darkseer do so little and so much at the same time. Like, there are moments when this Darkseer is the most important hero in the game, and there are other moments where you just completely forget he exists. Now he's smoked out. But he's gonna get popped by the Slaughter, and he wants absolutely nothing to do with it. He uses his 10-second BKB to get out, but that's fine. You are one Rax away from Mega-ing Na'vi.
I'll take your tribute.
Well, actually, that 10-second BKB would have actually been really nice. But Chubosh does not have a Blade Mail of his own. That's what I think he should get. I think he should get a Blade Mail, and then he should just right-click Ranged Rax. And Pycat can't kill him, because the Blade Mail. And Dandy can't disarm him, because the BKB. And then you get Megas, and then life's good. I say life's good, but chances are that even after Comanche gets Megas, this game will still go on for like another 10 more minutes. Now Dandy has his buyback. Been running again. Everyone except for Chubosh on Comanche has buyback. How's it going, everyone? I hope you're enjoying the KIEV Major Qualifiers. I sure have. It's been an exciting journey. Oh my god, something's about to happen. Smoke up on Na'vi. Tornado on to A. Is he gonna activate BKB when he hits the ground? No, he's gonna get up. Are they seriously going to wait for the 6th Roche before they go for Megas? Alright. Well, Pycat's gonna have BKB whenever that happens. And Darkseer's gonna have Pycat's gonna have buyback whenever that happens, and Darkseer's gonna have buyback. Pycat's gonna have buyback whenever that happens. Sanding is gonna have buyback whenever that happens. I can't believe they're waiting for the 6th Roche. no risks. Kyiver's sitting on 7k gold right now. He's not having a shark eaten. Has not bought a single pair of boots all game long. At this point, why bother? You are level 25. You have so much move speed. Even more move speed. Actually, not more move speed. Yeah, he's faster than Shikuchi. Oh yeah, obviously. I'm dumb. Look at this little gecko. Look at him go not into the enemy base. Hell, even Dazzle and Ogre are gonna have buyback at this trade. Man. It's the most farm I've seen a Dazzle in a very long time. Has a Lotus Orb complete. I haven't even looked at the support items yet. Actually, there are a few important items that have been completed. So, Pycat has not really done very much since completing that Daedalus. Still has not put anything on the berry yet, and still has not eaten a Moon Shard. Oh my god. Blink in onto the Dazzle, immediately gonna get Fire Blasted. RMN, not gonna be able to do very much, but he survives. On the right side of the fight, there's another active initiation on to Pycat. The time left is used. We get out two men. Yeah, down goes Pycat. Comanche guy LTW just a lot of Pycat immediately buys back. General going to survive just barely. This lone druid illusion does a lot of damage. In general, is not actually spotted out by the Crystal Nova. Three heroes go down. Shuvash had the right idea going in on this Dazzle because that split the fight up pretty well. Please don't tell me you're going for the 6th Roche. Come on! You've gotta be kidding me. They forced out Pycat's buyback! For no real reason, he just like bought back instantly. No one was in his base. He bought BOTs, but there wasn't really anything to BOT onto, I guess. Because his bear died, and so obviously he can't TP to the bear that doesn't exist. Now he buys BOT2s. And now Comanche A goes in with that double damage drone. There's a little bit of extra damage. Denti going in aggressively. This is Lincoln's product in silence as well by the Bloodthorn. He gets 4-step back into the Lotus Orb because the purge off the silence. General uses the epicenter, but it doesn't do very much of anything. As right now, down. Oh, there's a Spawn Hero Crush! And BKB's activating Glory. Denti goes down. General just barely gonna run out. Denti flies back. Ogre goes down. Comanche finally going to win this game. Can it be, Armin? Has his grave in one more second. A is taking a fair amount of damage from Dendi. He's going to go to the grave. Pycat is looking for some damage. Armin actually survives. General bought back as well. They're going to possibly get the kill on Shufash instead. LTW going in. A is so low. LTW dies, actually. Sardar dies and he buys back. She's sick onto the Crystal Maiden. She goes down. Never mind. Never mind. More. Cheapstick onto General. He has Burrow Strike in 3 more seconds. 4 staffs himself. Gonna continue following Zacko most likely. Gets the Burrow Strike. Yules up in 2 seconds, but General actually gets blocked out by these creeps. And now might have to be careful himself. Goes into Sandstorm. 6 Roches. 6 Roches. I'm pretty sure it's 6. These guys are still fighting down here. Vacuum is up. That goes like, oh, heals and hey, it's that gem! It's that gem that Nova never picked it up! Initiation onto Pycat. A is doing a lot of damage, and Pycat is surprisingly survivable! He goes down finally, but not before killing Sardar and putting him into dieback. And this respawn time talent means that even after that, this Pycat is going to be up again. A gets cold snapped, but there's no detection. You know why there's no detection? Because there's still a gem here. Sand King. Well, I mean, he needs all of those items, I guess, but, you know. Weaver gets out, and Weaver dying would have been pretty important. Nah, Weaver has buyback. No big deal. Crystal Maiden is a sheepstick. What is this game, even? Crystal Maiden is 12,000 net worth. Poor Biffer. This game is pure suffering for him. The bloodless these towers, bro.
This'll come in handy.
General, in a little bit of trouble, gets Blink Sheet by Zacko, vacuumed as well, Blink in by the Troll Bloodthorn. On top of that, he has Berserk when he hits the ground, he's gonna get out, uses the Swarm to, Sandstorm to get the bug off, but he's not gonna Sheepstick A! But General has buyback. And despite being mega'd, Nubir is still defending. These tier 4s are not taking very much damage, and they have Glyph as well. I'm still hungry. I was gonna eat something, like, after this first game, because, you know, I thought it was just gonna be, like, a game. It's only 65 minutes. It's not like we're in, like, 80-minute territory or something obscene like that, but, you know, still. Seeing as how Na'Vi had just been, like, getting destroyed within, like, first 10 minutes in all the other games that I've seen them play, I thought this was also gonna be the case. But no, this is a long, drawn-out, not necessarily destruction, but not we are still clearly not winning right now. We are approaching a 40,000 net worth difference right now. Hycat is going to have his buyback up in another 2 minutes. Here's what's going to happen. Comanche are going to go in with this Aegis. Glyph is going to get used, and they're immediately going to back off. At some point, they're gonna go in. Oh, nice crush on the two heroes. The two support heroes, but immediately Dazzle goes down. He buys back instantly. River goes down. He does not have buyback. Then he gets vacuumed in. Another two hero crush into Frostbite, into Wall. Then he goes into Ghostwalk. I can't believe he's still alive underneath this shallow grave. He's gonna survive with the Lone Disorder. But the right clicks of the Lone Druid Illusion actually get the kill. LTW going in. Pycat attacking everything but the Troll Warlord. He's going to survive with the Solar Crest. And A is actually going to die with that Aegis. He's going in there, Falcon diving, really want to kill this Pycat, but between the buyback of the Dazzle and the Shallow Graves, A is going in! He has buyback available as well, there's still a Glyph available. Buyback onto A, and Boker does not have buyback. Pycat still alive. Grave up on Sanakin, he heals himself up, has Burrow Strike as soon as he opens this Bloodthorn as soon as he hits the ground, means that he doesn't have Burrow Strike. Could it be? Burrow Strike buyback onto the Crystal Maiden, she's going to die? Again, she's alive! Okay, she's gonna die now. The agent, there's no Glyph! There's no Glyph! Hagat is going to die! General is going to die! Game is fine. I would not be. They can't survive for 67 minutes. Comanche finally.
corpse have been fortified. Tower has fallen.
With the infest, they blow up Burning. So Burning's dead, they'll force him to buy back. Meanwhile, mid in a little bit of trouble is maybe he's getting very low. He's got the Lotus Orb out on him, and there is the Remnant. And they will pop this Aegis. They're starting to surround him. Yup, they're slowing down IG. They're going to throw the Remnant on forward, and now maybe trying to set up that Requiem, and he will destroy Q on that Doom. Burning, he's going to have to time lapse. He's pretty far back, so he really needs to retreat back into that base. GG looking towards finishing off this game, and they're just a moment away. There's the epicenter use, there's the blink in. Might be in a little bit of trouble. He is maybe he's dead for 80 seconds. So buyback, he's gonna buy back, and now though IG trying to make their moment held. They're looking to find something, they're gonna lose this tank. GG coming through, trying to find a Doom on someone. Actually doesn't have Doom up. Scratch that, they lost from the side of LGD. It looks as though they'll lose a fourth in Ame, but not before he gets killed. Borax, so four die again on LGD, and they look to have almost had that game in their hands as Burning got very low after buying back. And now with that, they're going to boost the travel into the bottom lane. They've taken that tier 3, and now IG are looking to capitalize, force some buybacks out, and take racks of their own. There it is, Creeps pushing forward. Ame will buy back, still 30 seconds out. This Shadow Fiend, so he will continue to push, and there's the blink forward from OP. He's gonna smite a fist and Searing Chains the axe. There it is, and there it is.